So I'm actually going to begin with this picture of Arnold Schwarzenegger. And this is a talk about the pleasures of the text with reference to Roland Barthes and this spectacular body as a site of bliss. So what I'll be touching on today is the bliss of bodies and texts, bodies of work, maintenance mechanisms, and conversely, processes of dissolution, discourse networks, that is, the writing into and against being or meaning of so-called man or Superman coupled up to Schwarzeneggerian end times technology. So the pleasure produced by this terminating body is that of an aesthetics and discourse of the end and endings, an apocalyptic desire that therefore links to the nuclear state of exception, particularly because Arnold Schwarzenegger's equalized body also forms the embodiment of America's will to superpower. He is and remains, even though he's actually long outdated, the archetypal figure of the cyborg, itself a technology of bodybuilding, hooked up to machinery inherited from Nazi Germany, the Vergeltungswaffe 2, which in due course gives birth to its children, the American rockets named after gods. And here is the Saturn V, a monumental moon rocket prompting transformation for and in the loving subject. And you can see it standing here, obviously, next to the Statue of Liberty to give an indication of its size. But there are obviously other ideological forces at work, because this obviously is an engine of liberty and liberation and part of an arsenal of freedom. So cyborg and missile evolution are intimately linked, and Schwarzenegger's winning body articulates the desire to come into the machine. So George Butler and Robert Fiore's 1977 mock documentary Pumping Iron most clearly indicates the endless coming into mechanized being in the endless possibilities of the United States. And I'm going to show you a brief clip here from this film. Some of you might have already seen that.
The greatest feeling you can get in a gym, or the most satisfying feeling you can get in the gym, is the pump. Let's say you train your biceps, blood is rushing into your muscles, and that's what we call the pump. Your muscles get a really tight feeling, like your skin is going to explode any minute. You know, it's really tight, it's like somebody blowing air into your muscle. It just blows up and it feels different. It feels fantastic. It's as satisfying to me as coming is, you know, as having sex with a woman and coming. So can you believe how much I am in heaven? I'm like getting the feeling of coming in the gym, I'm getting the feeling of coming at home, I'm getting the feeling of coming backstage when I pump up, when I pose out in front of 5,000 people, I get the same feeling. So I'm coming day and night. I mean, it's terrific, right?
Terrific. Okay, so Jonathan Goldberg, in a fantastic essay on the mirrored stages of Arnold Schwarzenegger, notes how the pump locates an inadequacy within the symbolic, a lack at the very site of the realization of the equation of the penis and the phallus, so that this insistence on the pump, pumping, getting pumped, fails to secure the masculinity and heterosexuality of the Schwarzeneggerian, monstrously always coming subject. So a few things I'm going to do today. I will talk about failure in the act of taking control. And that's part one, which revolves around Arnold Schwarzenegger. And part two is about situating bodybuilding in a different tradition, working against the fiction of the body as totality and instrument to be mastered. So the second part is where the pleasures of the text, the body, specifically also refer to the pleasures of critical theory. Theory is a place or moment where the death of language is glimpsed. It is a way of cutting or perforating discourse, a mode of creative abrasion that delights in the destruction, the deconstruction of the verticality of language. So Roland Barthes is really, and above all, I think, talking about the practice of critical theory when he describes the text of bliss, the text that imposes a state of loss, the text that discomforts, perhaps to the point of a certain boredom, unsettles the reader's historical, cultural, psychological assumptions, the consistency of his tastes, values, memories, and brings to a crisis his relation to language. So what underlies all of this and all of my work is the fantasy formation of man, which is always a being that stands in quotation marks, marking off a possibility of disengagement from a ruinous and nuclear politics. So man, or the human as myth, a being determined above all by technologies of writing, and the hand already is technology, and it gestures, points towards thinking and speech. The hand can't be talked about, argues Derrida, without speaking of techniques. So there is a correlation then between body, pleasure, text, writing into meaning, but also writing against the specific Schwarzeneggerian being whose body formation refers to a fascist unconscious. So the Stahlgestalt is the figure of steel that Klaus Thuolite discusses in Male Fantasies with reference to the German Freikorps, volunteer armies that returned from World War I to become, after 1918, free-roaming shock troops that in time, if not exclusively, grow into the core of Hitler's Sturmabteilung. In the military academy, young boys are turned into stereometric figures, man plus, with reference to Frederick Pohl, but to Schwarzenegger as well, whose ghosted, ghost-written, but also fascist-ghosted education unfolds in a glossy book, smooth to the touch or slippery. So the sheen of the pages replicates the totally finished, polished form of its subject. So Arnold's The Education of a Bodybuilder is first published in 1977, the same year as Pumping Iron, and you can already sort of see the momentum building up to launch Arnold towards mega death or mega stardom. So this book here is concerned with establishing life as a force. The meta-narrative of Arnold's body is that of the machine. I didn't want to be delicate. I dreamt of big deltoids, big pegs, big thighs, big calves. I wanted every muscle to explode and be huge. I dreamt about being gigantic, a body welded into American orgasmic spectacle. So Austria, the Vaterland, is a civilization at a standstill or already in decline, seemingly paradisiacal, but already suggestive of an unproductive, unreproductive anti-culture. So Arnold dreams of an imperial expansion in the United States, where his desires for bulk and definition can be played out. And he feels the exhilaration of the interface between flesh and machine, the heavy steel plates that he lifts above his head. I loved the feel of cold iron and steel warming to my touch. So he positions himself with this book in a specifically American tradition, with reference to notably the education of Henry Adams, but also, if less explicitly so, with regards to Benjamin Franklin's work, The Perfectibility of Man. So everything to come exists with reference to the position that Schwarzenegger occupies in the United States. because his body of work, after all, is intent on demonstrating his subjecthood as an American, a super-determined citizen whose supersession into pumping superpower mirrors or reflects the US as nuclear superstate. So Schwarzenegger is the star at the dead center of California, or America's bodybuilding cult, established historically, amongst others, by Ben Franklin, founding father, who, according to D.H. Lawrence, is an automaton, setting up the dummy of a perfect citizen as a pattern to America. So this perfect citizen is Arnold Schwarzenegger, totally incorporating the myth of the United States. "I am going to be the master of you," he writes. "I have total control. I see people bending my way. I am jewel-like. I am empire." So effectively, Arnold is attracted to his mirror image, beginning with the bodybuilding routine near a lake in Graz. Graz, or Glass Lake, which anticipates the mirrored stages of Arnold Schwarzenegger at the gym, in love with his own extended being, the servo mechanism of his technologized image. America's empire of light, in reference to the movies, but also to the bomb, both as forms of an overwhelming and annihilating light. And the nation state manifest destiny are remembered in Schwarzenegger's super isometric corporeality as utopia of the body machine, imagined beyond its sluggish fallibility. So syntax to totally recall, pumping iron circulates around very few lexical fields in his book, established through these constant repetitions: the body, the verb to train, the pump, the blood. This is a new language: reps, sets, forced reps, presses, sculpting the body into armor, the imagination of total functioning, and a will that, to cite Nietzsche, thrusts forward again and again against that which stands in its way. So this obsessive litany, reps, sets, reps, is also a meditation, a form of transcendence through repetition, the transcendence of the I, already phallic subject, standing erect into Stahlgestalt, whose desire is incarcerated, building up to the point of eruption. So, but this spectacle really is that of an internal battle against a body in dissolution, the Schwarzeneggerian Stahlgestalt, in love with itself, though it may be, and produced in and through the mirror, insists it needs to determine its progress. Because in Pumping Iron, I mean, obviously the gym is full of mirrors, so there's this constant checking in the mirror, but also compared to the other bodybuilders. So there's this real interesting reflecting going on, not just in a technologized mirror, but also in the flesh, yeah, with all the other bodybuilders. So, and this progress is nothing other than a constant fear of what Georges Bataille calls the dissolute life, a threatening state of this disorder that also locates, to refer back to Jonathan Goldman, the lack of the phallus, just as it is indicative of a masculinity or hypermasculinity that always and invariably fails. The exploded limits that the pump suggests and enables is not a progress towards self-shattering, but the repetition, compulsion, and maintenance mechanisms of an always impossible and therefore totally disastrous ego pressing into crypto-fascist subjectivity. The mirrored body totality reflects the working of its own musculature so as to prevent it from being all used up. Okay, so this title is taken from Kathy Acker, who's an American experimental novelist and bodybuilder who, in an essay titled Against Ordinary Language, The Language of the Body, published in 1993, talks about wanting to record the raw material of her regular gym workouts. So after each workout, though, she forgets to write repeatedly. Some part of me, the part of the I who bodybuilds, was rejecting language, any verbal description of the processes of bodybuilding. So she begins then by analysing this rejection and impossibility announced through ellipses. She's attentive to these silences, which she compares to being speechless in a foreign country at the cusp of learning a new language. It is here in the gym, in this geography of no language, this negative space that I can start to describe bodybuilding, for I am describing that which rejects language. This is an extraordinary space and a reference, evidently, or I should say blissfully, to Jacques Derrida, the radical possibilities of absence as breaking force, a force of rupture, and Helene Cixous' work, The Laugh of the Medusa, Woman Must Put Herself Into the Text, Into Bodybuilding, a geography, history, world that is just on the point of being discovered. And you have these references to masturbation here. I write myself, I pleasure myself, I seek bliss at the point, the spot of coming into being, which is also the point at which I break up. I destroy or am destroyed. This is where I break away from the law. A world of searching, the elaboration of a knowledge on the basis of a systematic experimentation with the bodily functions, a passionate and precise interrogation of my erotogeneity. This practice, extraordinarily rich and inventive, in particular as concerns masturbation, is prolonged or accompanied by a production of forms, a veritable aesthetic activity, each state of rupture, inscribing a resonant vision, a composition, something beautiful. Beauty will no longer be forbidden. This practice has more to do with sublimity, though, than with beauty, with the formless than with form, in order to escape narrativity or composition at the point precisely of allowing its emergence. Hence Acker's ellipses, negative spaces that she refers to as failures, the failure of words. In a gym, she writes, a verbal language or language whose purpose of meaning occurs, if at all, only at the edge of its becoming lost. In The Pleasure of the Text, Roland Barthes is concerned with those same points, edges, cusps. And if I use lots of words and descriptions, it's because I delight in the same poetics of excess at the same time that it is a poetics of failure, because words obviously never are things, and they can only ever approach things that they stand for. Words on the page, to refer to Thomas Pynchon, are only ever delta T away from what they stand for. So pleasure happens, as I mentioned earlier, at the moment and place where the death of language is glimpsed. What pleasure wants, according to Barthes, is the sight of loss, the seam, the cut, the deflation, the dissolve, which seizes the subject in the midst of bliss. Hence, again, Acker's ellipses repeatedly, that distance between the eye and verbal articulation in the gym, this geography of no language, where the identity of the eye seeds or recedes into the inability to situate the subject in language. This is where I disappear. She too, like Arnold Schwarzenegger, mentions that new language, which in the gym is minimal and almost senseless, reduced to numbers and a few nouns, sets, squats, reps. The only verbs are do and fail. Adjectives and adverbs no longer exist. Sentences, if they are at all, are simple. In this strange, sacred, senseless space, Acker forgets, is momentarily left speechless. Her interpretation of bodybuilding exists with reference to critical theory, its practices of excess and failure that trouble the sentences, sentence making, the regime of the symbolic. Bodybuilding, rather than exclusively about the definition of the body, is about its unmaking too. The gym, after all, so full of mirrors, as heterotopic sight, a space that exists in the real world, but that gestures towards another yet to come. Over there, on the other side of the looking glass, I can reconstitute myself. But this reconstitution is not only or ultimately that of the Stahlgestalt, but also one where both the eye and narrativity are dismantled. Bodybuilding as failure, because muscles will grow only if they're not exercised or moved, but broken down. In order to break down specific areas of muscles, whatever areas one wants to enlarge, it is necessary to work these areas in isolation up to failure. Bodybuilding can be seen to be about nothing but failure. A bodybuilder is always working around failure. It is as such an unceasing performance of failure, pushing up against the limits of language and subjectivity in order to arrive at an elsewhere. Negative reps is about working the muscle group beyond its power to move. And that's a utopian proposal. I want to fail, in which failure functions as unending, compulsive repetition, fort da, in which I rehearse my own dissolution, re-emergence and disappearance beyond the power to move, even though the process looks exactly like it articulates a monstrosity or Schwarzeneggerian thing, an I thing of eternal growth and at the same time of a fundamental and paradoxical immobility. Which is obviously where the problem also lies. Acker's poetics of failure only works if it functions against outcome, against meaning. It works only as a critical theory project in the flesh, as it were, by working resolutely in terms of a resistance to meaning, to sentences that, like body formations, refuse the symbolic order in existence for a language game, sentenceless, senseless, beyond capacity. But still towards death, even if not necessarily towards Freud's inorganic stillness, rather than a tendency towards stability, which is how Freud describes the motive force of this beyond of the pleasure principle, Acker's language and body games work towards final failure, that is, total chaos. Oops, sorry, I thought I had another slide up there. By trying to control, to shape my body through the calculated tools and methods of bodybuilding and time and again in following these methods, failing to do so, I am able to meet that which cannot be finally controlled or known, the body. The I as other, an abject subjectivity fascinated by death, violence, masturbatory pleasures, formed, deformed, reformed, unmade constantly at the hand of a critical tradition in favour of the dissolute life, the jouissance of failure coming into non-being. Acker's geography of no language is at a point of threshold beyond which the obscene body can exist negatively through failure against the production of meaning, refusing absolute form. Bodybuilding, then, as indicative of what Deleuze and Guattari called desubjectivization, in opposition to the stereometric, the gigantic Esquerette or Schwarzenegger engine blasting his muscles. Gym as site of body loss, ego loss, as mirrored labyrinth in which I bodybuild or desubjectify. And yet Acker still articulates this process as one of closure. I close the body's outer windows to look inside, even as she celebrates breaches. Bodybuilding remains here an exploration of enclosure, even as it imagines dissolution. So Acker's practice as an alternative discorporeality to the conservative utopia of the Schwarzeneggerian Stahlgestalt is nonetheless in danger of upholding ideas of the opposite, darkness against light, depth against outer boundary, and which is also actually reflected in the structure of this talk, male against female, even though I want to violently work against that structure. But maybe at the same time, it's indicative of how caught up I am in it. So the radical nature of Acker's work as worker in the body has to lie with the conceptualization of the body as site of failure, an interiority in or against which I don't seek mastery or defense, but where I take pleasure in the disturbance and deconstruction of an imperial crypto-fascist sovereignty. Okay, thanks very much.